Greetings, junior scientists, scientists, and citizens, great big weird welcome, wonderful world in which we live. As always, I'm your humble science communicator, the great Orbax, coming to you here from the Department of Physics at the University of Guelph. I'd like to welcome you to our May 2022 Stargazing Guide. As we hurriedly saunter into May, we celebrate the peak of spring and the rapidly approaching summer months. May signifies a great many things to a great many people here on Earth, but up there, we have some incredible celestial events taking place. This month, we have a planetary conjunction, spring constellations, and a blood flower moon lunar eclipse, which I've got to say is probably the greatest name for anything that I've ever announced on here. All of these we can easily see if we just take some time to look up. Our stargazing adventures, we've talked a lot about famous constellations, but this month I'd like to introduce you to two new constellations that we've never met before. In January, we talked about the quadranted meteor shower, and it was then that we met Bootes. Visible near Bootes in the east-southeast sky are Canes Venatici and Coma Berenices. These are northern constellations, which means that they can only be seen in the northern celestial hemisphere. Canes Venatici translates to hunting dogs in Latin, and the constellation represents Asterion and Chara, the dogs of Bootes the herdsman. This constellation contains the star La Superba, which is one of the brightest red stars in the sky. See if you can spot it, junior scientists! Right beside Canes Venatici is Coma Berenices, or Berenices' hair. While not a large constellation, it contains a number of interesting deep space objects, including the northern part of the Virgo cluster of galaxies, the closest cluster of galaxies to the Milky Way. That's us!
The Ojibwe of the Great Lakes call the May full moon Zagabaga Gizas, or the budding moon, signifying a time when Mother Earth again provides healing medicine. The Cree of North America and the Mi'kmaq associate the May moon with the croaking of frogs, while the Cherokee call it the planting moon, when the fields are plowed and sown. Similarly, most European cultures refer to it as the corn planting moon, the milk moon, or the flower moon. Actually, this month, we have a blood flower moon lunar eclipse. That's right. A full lunar eclipse will take place on the night of May 15th into the morning of May 16th.
So what exactly is a lunar eclipse? You're likely familiar with a solar eclipse. Now, this occurs when the moon passes between the Earth and the sun. But what's a lunar eclipse? Well, a lunar eclipse occurs when the moon actually falls into the Earth's shadow. But the moon appears to line up with the Earth like this twice a month, during new moon and full moon. So why don't we have eclipses twice a month then? Well, it's actually a little more complicated than that. The plane of the moon's orbit around the Earth is actually tilted with respect to the plane of the Earth's orbit around the sun. But here's the thing, the moon's orbit stays fixed with respect to the stars, meaning that tilt actually changes with respect to the Earth. And twice a year, it actually lines up in such a way that the moon passes through the Earth's shadow, and that is when we have a lunar eclipse. As the moon passes through the Earth's shadow, it'll still be visible, and it might even have a red tinge to it. So why is that? As light passes through the Earth's atmosphere, it's scattered, meaning that shorter wavelengths like blue light are actually diverted away from the moon, whereas longer wavelengths like red light are what pass through and illuminate the moon. As a matter of fact, if you happen to be standing on the moon during the lunar eclipse, you'd actually be bathed in a red glow and see a red ring emanating from around the Earth, which is all that remains of the light escaping Earth's atmosphere, of all the sunrises and sunsets that are taking place along the edge of the Earth.
Now, unlike a solar eclipse, it's perfectly safe to look at a lunar eclipse with the unaided eye, a pair of binoculars, or even a telescope. Here at the University of Guelph, and in most of North America, we'll be able to see the lunar eclipse in its entirety. It will begin at approximately 9:32 p.m. on May 15th, when the moonlight starts to dim. Around 10:30 p.m., areas of the moon will be covered in darkness, and the full eclipse will take place from 11:29 p.m. to about 12:53 a.m., when the moon will be bathed in that reddish glow that we talked about before. The moon will continue to be in shadow until about 2:50 a.m. on May 16th. Now, talking about moons, on May 30th is a new moon, which means that we'll have plenty of dark sky at the end of the month for our stargazing. Our pals Jupiter and Mars will be exchanging positions in the pre-dawn sky from May 28th to the 30th. You should be able to see this with the unaided eye, but if you have a pair of binoculars or a small telescope, point it towards the southeast sky just before dawn, and you'll see conjunction occur on May 29th. You might even be able to see one of Jupiter's bigger moons. While we cruise into the summer months, it can be daunting to think that our hours of evening stargazing are decreasing. However, I guarantee you, junior scientists, that our best days are yet to come, and all we've got to do is look up. Don't forget to have a science-tastic day!
Special thanks to Royal City Science's own planetary geochemist, Dr. Glynis Parrott, for her help preparing our stargazing guide. We'd also like to thank the SkyView app and the Royal Astronomical Society of Canada.